I'm Stacy. Have you ever had a friend who wouldn't do anything by herself, who even dragged you along to her haircut? She's a bit dependent. How about someone who talks a lot without taking a breath between topics? His sentences run on and on and on. Consider these special friends as we discuss sentence structure. Sentences require proper connecting words, punctuation, and only some can stand up on their own. In this lesson, we'll talk about the components of a complete sentence. Let's start by reviewing clauses. A clause is a group of related words with a subject and a verb. You know what a clause is. This isn't new information. But do you remember the two different types of clauses? An independent clause can stand on its own and make sense as a simple sentence. For example, "We went to the movies" is an independent clause. It makes sense by itself and stands as a simple sentence. In contrast, a dependent clause cannot stand alone because it doesn't express a complete thought. For example, "After we ate cheeseburgers" is a dependent clause. It doesn't make sense on its own, and it cannot stand on its own as a sentence. A sentence with a dependent and independent clause is a complex sentence. If we had said, "After we ate cheeseburgers, we went to the movies," it would be a complex sentence. In this case, "After we ate cheeseburgers" is the dependent clause which cannot stand on its own. Now let's look at compound sentences. A compound sentence is a sentence with more than one independent clause. We end up with a run-on sentence anytime we have two independent clauses that are only joined by a comma. If our sentence read, "We ate cheeseburgers, we went to the movies," it would be a run-on sentence. We could say we ate cheeseburgers, and we could say we went to the movies since both are independent clauses. But if we want to put them together in one sentence, we have to use fanboys. What are fanboys, you ask? It's actually an acronym for the coordinating conjunctions that we need to use when joining two independent clauses. Fanboys are for, and, nor, but, or, yet, and so. When using fanboys to connect two independent clauses, a comma is always needed. When using fanboys to connect an independent and dependent clause, a comma is not needed. Okay, time to go through an SAT problem together to apply these concepts. Jane is a talented athlete, yet she did not make the varsity team. Our answer choices are different ways of writing the underlined portion in the question sentence. Our original sentence is made up of two independent clauses. The first is, "Jane is a talented athlete," and the second is, "She did not make the varsity team." As we just covered, two independent clauses need to be joined by fanboys and a comma. The original sentence uses "yet" to represent the fanboys, but it doesn't have a comma. So we know that we can eliminate answer choice A, because we do need to make a change to the original sentence. Answer choice B is incorrect because it adds a semicolon but removes "she," which makes the second clause a dependent clause. Answer choice C removes "she" as well, but doesn't add a punctuation mark. The sentence becomes, "Jane is a talented athlete, yet did not make the varsity team." So we now have an independent clause and a dependent clause joined by one of our fanboys without a punctuation mark, which we just learned is correct. Answer choice C is our answer. All right, we've got clauses and fanboys down, so let's shift gears and take a look at semicolons. The semicolon joins two closely related independent clauses within a single sentence. For example, let's look at the sentence, "We ate ribs, they were delicious." We ate ribs. That's an independent clause. It could be a sentence on its own. "They were delicious." That's also an independent clause. If you need proof, let's quickly write it as a sentence. "They were delicious, period." Yes, that's a sentence. We can't use a comma to join two independent clauses. But if we replace the comma with a semicolon, it will read, "We ate ribs, they were delicious." Now we have two independent clauses correctly joined by a semicolon. But what if we wanted the sentence to be more expressive? Conjunctive adverbs are another group of connectors that can link independent clauses and require the semicolon when they're used in this way. Conjunctive adverbs include "nevertheless," "indeed," "accordingly," "however," "consequently," "therefore," "in addition," and "subsequently." Let's go back to our sentence about cheeseburgers and movies. "We ate cheeseburgers." That's an independent clause. "We went to the movies." That's also an independent clause. We could join these two independent clauses with a semicolon, but it's not a very good sentence. A conjunctive adverb would really come in handy.
Add a conjunctive adverb like subsequently, and our sentence, we ate cheeseburgers, we went to the movies, becomes we ate cheeseburgers, subsequently we went to the movies. Much better. Just remember the correct order. Semicolon, conjunctive adverb, then comma. The semicolon's cousin, the colon, actually works in the same way. Colons can be used to introduce lists and to join two independent clauses, but it implies that an explanation will follow. The graduation went well. Everyone was impressed by the valedictorian speech. The graduation went well, and everyone was impressed by the valedictorian speech are both independent clauses. While each can stand alone, the second clause builds on the information given in the first. This is how colons work. The colon and semicolon are similar, so study each one, along with clauses and fanboys, and you'll be well on your way to knowing everything you need to know about connectors and proper sentence structure. Now that you've learned about sentence structure, make sure you solve some of the many practice problems available throughout this course.